Hi, Eni.
Hi.
It's very good to meet you.
And you.
We'd just like to know a few things about what it takes to be a footballer of your caliber. So can you take us wherever you want to go with the story of like how you became a footballer?
Well, how I became a footballer was really football kind of met me, really. When I was young, I think I was just born with the gift of being able to play football, and my environment brought it out of me. I grew up in Birmingham on a local estate, and I had a younger brother. I've got a younger brother that's 2 years younger than me, and there was a lot of boys in the local area, so who all played football, and my quickest way of sort of fitting in and being accepted in that group was to play football as well. And then I soon realised I was actually better than them. And so it became sort of like, you know, my form of acceptance and fitting in. It became my identity, or the girl that plays football and, you know, that's better than the boys. And that's kind of how my relationship with football started. It was very much a strong piece of identity for me. You know, as a young black girl growing up in Birmingham with no other girls around, it was my quickest route to feeling like somebody. When I was growing up, which for young people, I think is a big thing. You know, feel who are you when you're young and you're trying to feel your way through identity. You know, football was a huge part of that.
You're Nigerian, and you're in the British team. How has that been received, like in the Nigerian community? Was there a time you wanted to play for Nigeria?
When I was growing up, there was never really an option to play for the Nigerian women's team. You know, no one ever sort of called me or reached out to me about it. I think it's much more different for men. You know, my brother, for instance, played for Nigeria, and, you know, he had the option of playing for England as well. For me, that wasn't really the case. But, you know, my whole sort of upbringing and my education in football was in England. And, you know, so for me, my dream, as any other girl I was playing with, was to play for England, because, you know, that is part of my identity. You know, we all have these hyphenated identities. You know, we grew up in Birmingham, but I born in Nigeria, raised in England. You know, that's part of me. We're not sort of one dimensional in who we are. So being British and playing for England is very much part of me, just as it is anybody else. But obviously being Nigerian is also part of me. And so I'm really keen on connecting with Nigeria and understanding my background. And so I'm very conscious of that. And, you know, I think Nigerian fans really want to own me as well. And particularly when I'm doing well and, you know, I'm being successful, they like the fact that, you know, you can recognize from my name straight away that I'm Nigerian. And so that's a great feeling. It's a great feeling because I think Nigerians generally are passionate about football. And so the reaction to me has always been very, very positive. Of course, you get the banter about, you know, why didn't you choose to play for Nigeria? But I think overall it's very, very
positive. Because they're proud of you, I guess.
Yeah, I think it comes from a prideful place.
When was the last time you were in Nigeria?
I was in Nigeria a few months ago, actually. Whenever I have sort of 5 or 6 days, I like to go to Africa. I think Africa's good for the soul. Obviously Nigeria's, you know, part of my home, and I've got family there, I've got friends there, and it's a very vibrant place. Lagos is, you know, a vibrant place. It's surrounded by water. I really love water, and it's got great fashion. It's got great vibe. I think Africa in general gets a bad rap in the news, and I think people have such bad misconceptions about Africa. There is a lot of affluence in Nigeria, and I think people assume that that comes from corruption. I think people assume that it comes from a bad place, and I think that's what the news sometimes quite too easily pushes out. But actually, you know, entrepreneurship is huge in Africa. You know, there's so many creative people that make businesses out of nothing, that make money through their own creativity. There's so many people that are so educated, have been educated abroad, who've come back and developed, you know, Lagos and developed their own environment. Last time I was there, I went to visit the Nikki Art Gallery.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a big fan of art, so I went to visit there. It's one of the biggest art galleries in Africa, I think, if not the biggest. And I met the owner and bought a piece of art there and just, you know, really experienced, you know, African creativity and African art. I've been to concerts, I've been to fashion shows, and I think fashion in Nigeria is growing and is starting to influence the world now. I think music now, Afrobeats, some of the, you know, Wizkid is one of my favorite artists. He's a global icon, you know, he's really influencing not just his own music, but, you know, the music of other artists as well. And so I think there's a real positivity to now in general about Africa. You know, I think Black Panther did a great, did great with that, just kind of impressing upon people that Africa is, you know, it is in terms of its resource, a global superpower. But yes, I think we're at a disadvantage because there has been a lot of corruption and there's sort of still post residue of colonialization. But generally now I think that you're seeing a sort of resurgence and a push forward of, you know, so many different elements of African culture. And for me, I'm part of that as well. You know, I may play for England or I may have an English accent, but I identify with that. And as long as I'm doing positive things as well, I'm inspiring, you know, African girls all around the world. For me, as somebody in diaspora, you know, I think it's really important to connect to your roots and try and add to the resurgence, if you like, of, you know, African the African experience, not just in Africa but around the world as well.
Mm-hmm. So many people are good at two things, but they choose one.
Yeah.
You know, but you've chosen law and professional football, and you're good at both. How have you had to negotiate that? When was it at its most difficult, and what are the benefits of that now?
Yeah, I think from a young age, I've kind of always liked to do different things. You know, when I started playing football, I was playing tennis as well. And, you know, I've kind of liked having two different things going on at the same time.
Hmm.
But I think for me, really, my parents were always very keen on me to focus on my education, because I think for women's football, it's a lot more sensitive to breakdown. You know, you're not necessarily, there wasn't necessarily a professional pathway that was obvious for me when I was growing up. There is now, but not when I was growing up. So education was something I couldn't really compromise. And so that's why I've always had to have it as a parallel focus. But when I got much older, I realized it was something that was actually very healthy for me to have a different focus, a different energy to tap into. Because I think when your eggs are all in one basket in football, injury can really get you down. You know, coaches' decisions can really get you down. Having something else that defines you, having a different energy, having a different focus, engaging a different part of your brain, really helped me to just kind of deal with some of the difficulties. And balancing it all actually was really something I found quite enjoyable. It was hard during exams, and but I didn't compromise it. So, and I think it's paid off. I went to university for 3 years at Brunel, did law, and then I was kind of in a limbo situation because I was playing semi-professional at the time for Charlton, and then moved to Chelsea for a year. And then I just didn't really know, okay, am I going to go into law full-time? Am I going to continue playing football? And then an amazing opportunity came for me to go to America and play in the professional league there, which was incredible. Fortunately for me, the owner of the team, St. Louis, was also a lawyer. And so he offered me the opportunity to work for his firm in the off-season. And so I was able to kind of do both. That was my first professional experience of playing as a professional footballer, but I could also develop as a lawyer as well. So that was an incredible experience for me.
What is it that we, the fan, the punter, doesn't get to understand about what it actually takes to be a footballer?
Well, I think from a young age, it's always taken sacrifice. You know, when it started getting, when I started realizing that this isn't just a hobby for me, this is something that I wake up wanting to do, I realized that I had to sacrifice a lot. So I didn't necessarily have the teenage experience like other people did. I couldn't really go out drinking and, you know, being irresponsible. It was the time management, it's the sacrifice, it's the missing weddings, it's the missing funerals. It's not going out with your mates and your mates telling you they're boring. It's all that stuff as a young person, you might not think about it, but it kind of shapes who you are and your readiness to become a professional athlete. Football's the centerpiece for our family, you know, and particularly with my brother, who's obviously a professional at Reading. You know, football has been something that we've always referenced and talked about, and it's kind of a microcosm for us as well for life in general. You know, we see it as a blessing. You know, we're very strong Christians in our family, and you know, we see that we see it very much as God has gifted us with you know, the talent to play football, and we're very much a vessel to show kind of how much you can achieve in life through football. You know, I'm just carrying out my own purpose, that, you know, there's something much greater than me. And I think that really helps, you know, because when you're humble, you don't let success get to your head, but also you don't let failure get to your heart, because it's part of life. You know, I've definitely made mistakes, but I think whenever I'm going through adversity, my faith has also helped as well.
Annie, when you were a footballer and you were playing in Birmingham, what was the memory that you have that said, you know what, I want to do this professionally?
I think when I started playing for the school teams and, you know, scoring lots and lots of goals, like winning games on my own, I think that's when I was like, okay, you know, this is a great feeling. This is something that I can really do. I was really excelling, you know, at kind of age 8, 9, in a whole exclusively boys teams and boys tournaments. So I think that's where I thought, right, okay, this is really something I want to do.
And what was the pushback? Because you're saying sometimes there were, you know, were the boys okay with that, or were they?
Yeah,
cool?
I mean, I think a lot the boys saw it as something that was cool, but I think the parents of other teams didn't like it. You know, they kind of, because they've never seen it before. So usually when people haven't seen something before, they fear it or they undermine it, and so, you know, I became sort of, oh, well, there's no rules that say girls can play. Or why is she playing? You're cheating. All this stuff that, and because they were adults, it really got to me, because they should have known better, you know. So that's when it was really, really challenging for me. And I think at one time I just didn't want to play because I just didn't want the aggro of having to deal with that all the time. And I kind of had a choice to make at that time. Do I be the weird girl that plays football that's kind of offensive to, you know, the norm, and for coaches who just didn't really want to accept that I was different, or do I just do it anyway? So from a young age, I learned that the only way to shut people up, if you like, is to perform and to be successful and to do well. That's the best answer.
I've noticed, particularly with African footballers or footballers of African origin, they give a lot back to either the institution they're in, so here's the, you know, Chelsea and all of that, but also to their own countries. And is that something you'd be willing to talk about? Is, you know, like that?
Because yeah, I mean, I think a lot of footballers don't talk about it because it's not about them. You know, it's about who they're giving to. I think the minute you see, you know, somebody talking so much about what they're doing for others, it's really kind of probably about them and how good they feel about it. So I actually think it's a good thing that you sort of find out by chance that, you know, Mohamed Salah has set up a hospital in Egypt, and, you know, he's not shouting about it to the rooftops. I think, you know, for me, I'm really passionate about young women. I'm really passionate about female empowerment. You know, I've teamed up with the UN Women over the past 18 months to you know, speak to young women about, you know, all kinds of issues like confidence, self-worth, you know, working in high-pressure environments, not compromising your womanhood, breaking through glass ceilings, you know, talking to diversity groups about, you know, how to make your difference or your ethnicity a positive thing rather than something that's burdensome all the time. You know, I set up a company 2 years ago called Crescendo Sport that helps young people get into the sports industry from any background, from any study discipline, and helps with internships and work placements, and using my network that I've built over the past 15 years to now help young people that can't get into the game. I've really enjoyed that. It's been very rewarding, and a very rewarding initiative for me.
What's your guilty pleasure?
I've been really, really trying to do this vegan diet.
Yeah.
Right? But my brother's done it. He's done it very successfully. He's told me all the benefits of having more energy, feeling lighter, etc. I tried to do it and I was seeing chicken in my dreams. Like, it was hard.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? So
how long did you last?
A week.
That's not bad.
Chicken right now is something that I'm trying to run away from. Yeah. But it's not working.
So that's your
chicken
pleasure.
Chicken wings with nice spiced chicken wings for me are just, it's like temptation overload.